my brothers and sisters in Christ. God has awakened us to another bright new day. And today we celebrate the feast of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Let us rejoice then and be glad in this day that the Lord has made. Prayer begins with our opening sentence for major sins on page 35 and continues thereafter on page 36 and following. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. We pray together. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. 790. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his and he made it. His hands molded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he himself is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. If only you would hear his voice today, for he comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and shall be forever. Amen. And we have this opportunity now to open our hearts and to confess to Almighty God all that we have done, where we have not followed in the way that He wants us to go. Let us ask God for forgiveness as we bring to mind some of those things by which we have offended against God and man. So let us confess our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now come to our Psalms, two Psalms we have this morning, Psalm 113 and Psalm 115. And so we turn to page 621, where 113 is found, and 622, where 115 is found. So we follow with Psalm 115 right after 113. So let us recite the Psalms together. Hallelujah! Give praise, you servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be blessed from this time forth forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its going down, let the name of the Lord be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who sits enthroned on high, but stoops to behold the heavens and the earth? He takes up the weak out of the dust, and lifts up the poor from the ashes. He sets them with princes, with the princes of his people. He makes the woman of a childless house to be a joyful mother of children. Psalm 115. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory because of your love and because of your faithfulness. Why should the heathen say, where then is their God? Our God is in heaven. Whatever he wills to do, he does. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. They have mouths, but they cannot speak. Eyes have they, but they cannot see. They have ears, but they cannot hear. Noses, but they cannot smell. They have hands, but they cannot feel. Feet, but they cannot walk. They make no song with their throat. Those who make them are like them, and so are all who put their trust in them. O Israel, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord has been mindful of us, and he will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, both small and great together. May the Lord increase you more and more, you and your children after you. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The heaven of heavens is the Lord's, but he entrusted the earth to its peoples. The dead do not praise the Lord, nor all those who go down into silence. But we will bless the Lord from this time forth, forevermore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now we have our reading, our first reading, from the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel, chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Hannah prayed and said, my heart exults in the Lord. My strength is exalted in my God. My mouth derides my enemies, because I rejoice in my victory. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry are fat with spoil. The barren has borne 7, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low, he also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness. For not by might does one prevail. The Lord, his adversary, shall be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the power of his anointed. This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. We come now to our canticle. And our canticle is taken, is the Magnificat, written to page 67 of our Books of Common Prayer, as we recite the Magnificat together. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in you, O God, my Saviour. For you have looked with favour on your lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. You, the Almighty, have done great things for me, and holy is your name. You have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You have shown strength with your arm and scattered the proud in their conceit, casting down the mighty from their thrones and lifting up the lowly. You have filled the hungry with good things, and the rich you have sent away empty. You have come to the help of your servant Israel, for you have remembered your promise of mercy, the promise made to our forebears and to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Now we continue with our second reading. Our second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants were drawn the water knew, The steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother, his brothers, and his disciples, and they remained there for a few days. This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. Today we reflect on this feast of St. Mary the Virgin. We reflect on this young Virgin Mary. We reflect on her faith and her courage. And we pray, even as we reflect on this young girl at that particular, engaged to be married, you know, her courage, her faith, you know, to step out in the unknown, trusting in God. And we pray that in our own lives, Father, we reach that point where, even as you call upon us to some particular task that you have in store for us, in some way that you want to use us, Lord, in your great scheme, or in some small way, whether big or small, we pray, Lord, that we would have the same as we read and reflect today on Mary's story. It will help us, Lord, as we seek to respond to the many ways in which you are calling us into your service. So Mary, we remember, was a young virgin, betrothed, engaged to be married. And we are told in those days they were living apart, the engaged or the betrothed, but they were essentially, you know, it was much more than what an engagement is nowadays. They were essentially married. And here was this young Virgin Mary, the angel of God, Angel Gabriel, appeared to her, and the angel greeted her. And here is what in this young virgin was called to do. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." The assurance that God is with her and God will be with her. And what Mary was called to do? "And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son. And you will name him Jesus." Jesus means Savior. He will be the Savior of the world. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. But of his kingdom there'll be no end. So his a son, God had great things in mind for Mary. She would bear a son who would be really Savior, Jesus Savior. He would be the Son of the Most High. And that is Jesus. God is calling Mary to be the Son of the One who will be Savior of the world. But Mary, this young virgin, knew enough, of course, couldn't understand. How can this be, since I'm a virgin? How am I going to have this child? And I guess that question was just more than that. Yes, how is that going to happen? But of course, there's also the question that Mary would have. You know, I am betrothed, I'm engaged to be married. How can I even have a child? I have not had any kind of sexual relations with my fiancé. How can this be? How is this going to happen? This is extraordinary. And the angel said to her, well, you know what? God is in this. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And the child, and therefore the child to be born, will be holy. He'll be the very Son of God. The Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, will come to you and the Most High will overshadow you. And the child will be conceived. And he will be the very Son of God. But Mary is only human. She will have to answer questions of her fiancé, from her fiancé, from her family, from the entire community. How did you get pregnant? You're betrayed to Joseph. You aren't living together. How come? So this Mary, yes, has to consider, what will all this lead to? What is my life going to be like? You know? And we can imagine this young woman, very young. In those days, I suppose 14 or 15, you know, essentially, and that's the time that women would be married in her time. Young girls would be married. We call them young girls today. But they'd be in their time, they'd be women, ready to start their families, ready to be married. And what a heavy weight. You might say Mary had enough excuses to say, well, no, I can't do this. And the angel continued. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. So the angel is pointing out, you know, this is the kind of thing that God can do. This is God acting. And Mary, of course, who herself would be among those who would, you know, say, well, Elizabeth is well past childbearing age. But the angel is assuring her that that same cousin Elizabeth, who everybody considered barren, even you, she is pregnant. That is God's work. That is the power of God. Nothing will be impossible with God. The angel used that example of this supposedly barren, supposedly old woman becoming pregnant. And the angels are showing her, this is God. This is God's work. This is the way God works. Nothing is impossible with God. And we are told that Mary, you know, despite all her concerns, and she must have deep concerns, she has to face her fiancé, she has to face her parents, she has to face her community. And that is no easy thing for this young woman. But God is in the middle of it. Even her barren, in inverted commas, older cousin, is now pregnant. That is God's work. Nothing, the angel assures her. So have no fear. Do not be afraid. With God, all things are possible. Nothing will be impossible with God. And of course, in the face of all of that, Mary takes that. It's important. Mary takes that step into the unknown. She doesn't know where it will all lead her, what she will have to face. She doesn't know. But nothing is impossible with God. She can make that step into the unknown because God is in the midst of it. And that kind of faith, that kind of deep understanding from within us, that is what you and I would like to have. So that when God is calling us in our turn, in our time, God is still calling us. Let's just remember that. God is still working in the world, and God uses you and I. God uses people, human beings. God uses us. We are the ones who are to do God's work in the world. And God is in all kinds of ways calling us. Not necessarily dramatically like this, with an angel appearing to us, but in all kinds of ways God is speaking to us. Other people may come to ask us to get involved in God's work. We might be seeing, God might be presenting to us regularly a particular situation or set of situations that needs our particular intervention. We might even have a dream. People might be coming to ask us, you know, to get involved in a certain ministry. God is calling us in all kinds of ways. And the thing about us is, we to be honest, we have developed a whole set of excuses as to why we can't do this, why we can't do that. We don't have time. One of the biggest excuses, we don't have time. The question for us is, whose time is it? You know, God can pull the plug like next, the very next minute. The time is God's time. It is God's time, not our time. And we, in the time that we are given, we cannot give God back some of our time. Give back some time to his service. And any other resource that we have, or money. It's God who has enabled us to earn that. So we can't give God back some of that money. Knowing that he's the one who enables us, he could strike us down tomorrow. We could be invalided tomorrow or next minute. So we are earning, and we find it so hard to give God all of what he has enabled us to earn. He's given us talents, and we find it so hard to give some of our talents. It will take some effort, yes. Yes, we have to make, as it were, reorganize. It's a question of reorganizing our lives to be able to give more, to be able to give more money, to be able to give more time, to be able to give more talent, more of our talents. We'll have to make God a greater priority, a greater part of our lives. That is the commitment. What is our real relationship with God? God has given us everything. And our calling is to give back to God without counting the minutes, the dollars, you know, the time, the talent. We have to understand God has given us everything. Mary stepped out in the unknown. Once we get in there, and that's the big problem. We are often afraid that once we get into what this particular area of service that God is calling us to go into, once we get into that, you know, our lives would go in a way that we, you know, we wouldn't necessarily want it to go. We don't know what will happen. If we start in a little way, we step our toe in, next thing you know, all our time is gone there. You know, that's our concern. That commitment. But think of Mary, this young girl. You know, what will be her situation? Think of it. But God is in the midst of it. With God, all things are possible. And we imagine that is, you know, the particular consideration that made all the difference for Mary. She didn't know where, what would happen to her, what would people will say, what her family will say, what Joseph will say. He'd probably, you know, just put her aside. But God is in the midst of it, and she was able, and we are all called to do that, to make that step into the unknown, trusting God. That is faith. But yes, Mary had a huge task, a big task, that is to be the mother, to be the bearer of the very Son of God. Yes, admittedly, that's much greater. the greatest perhaps. But we too in our own little ways, earthly beings here today in this time, we have roles to play. God has equipped us with time, talent, skills, you know, even finances, some of us. And all of us, as a matter of fact, we are called to give some of what we have. And the question for us, are we prepared to take that step into the unknown, trusting God, not knowing where it will lead us? You know, be afraid of that commitment. We have to commit ourselves to God through faith, through commitment. It is really, you know, that is really where our issue lies. Where will it all lead to? I might be totally consumed with this. I have my life to live. Who's given us life? God can take it away in a moment. Who's given us our money, our time, our talent? It's all God's. And we must trust God. We must have the faith. God is going to use us. God is going to take care of us. And so Mary's example is one that I would just say shames us. And we reflect on it. It literally shames us because she committed herself so totally into God's hands. She didn't even know what is going to happen to her. Where would that lead all? She didn't know. But she committed herself. And we want to see, you know, what assurances we want, I don't know. You know, but we are afraid to commit our time, commit our talents, commit our money into God's service. And in that sense, I would say Mary's example shames us. We are not prepared to step out into that unknown. That is what faith is, to step out in the unknown, to give ourselves over to God's purposes and to go wherever that will lead us. And that is Mary's gift to us. Mary's example to us. So next time someone comes to ask us to join in some kind of ministry, let us do like Mary and trust God. Next time we have to reflect on what we're going to give to God in terms of our money. Let us take a step into the unknown and, you know, trusting in God. Next time someone comes to ask us to, you know, give up our time and skill and talent and money, let us remember Mary's example. She had no idea where it will all lead. But God was calling her. Nothing is impossible with God. And she made that step into the unknown. She became the very mother of the Son of God, Savior, Jesus, Savior of the world. We in our own way can do great things for God if we will only answer the call. The Lord be with you.
Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. May my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine.
We continue with the Apostles' Creed on page 42 of our Books of Common Prayer. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayer that our Savior has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Today we turn to page 187 for our collect, the collect for St. Mary the Virgin. Let us pray. O God, you have taken to yourself the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of your incarnate Son. Grant that we, who have been redeemed by His blood, may share with her the glory of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we continue in prayer. Father, this morning as we celebrate the Feast of St. Mary, we pray, Lord, for that same faith and dedication in our own lives. We pray, Lord, that we too will be able to respond to your call to serve your purposes in the world. Help us, Lord, to recognize when your voice is calling us into your service, to have the strength and the courage to be able to make that sacrifice, to put behind the things of the world, Lord, and to respond faithfully to your call to serve. And we continue to pray. Into your hands, Lord, we commend ourselves this day. Let your presence be with us to its close. Strengthen us to remember that in whatever good work we do, we are serving you. Give us a diligent and watchful spirit, that we may seek in everything to know your will, and knowing it, may gladly perform it, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue to pray. We pray for God's church worldwide and for God's people everywhere. We pray especially for those who live in countries where there is war and fighting and death and destruction, where there are natural disasters, where the daily life is just a struggle. We pray for people living under all those difficult circumstances. We pray for an end to war and fighting, for your peace in the hearts of men and women everywhere. And Lord, give strength and courage to your people who are striving every day against all kinds of challenges and odds. We pray, Lord, that you'll give them the strength and courage that they might be sources of hope and strength to others around them. And we pray for your church worldwide, for all who are ministers of your word and sacraments, Lord. We pray that you will strengthen them so their lives will be truly examples to others. Strengthen them in your service. We pray, Father, especially for the Anglican Communion worldwide, for all the provinces in our communion and all the primates of our provinces. We pray especially for the Most Reverend Justin Welby, who is Archbishop of Canterbury. In our own church, the church in the province of the West Indies, we pray for Howard, our Archbishop, also Bishop of Jamaica, for your wisdom and grace and strength as he leads the province at this time. For all the bishops of our dioceses in this province, may your hand, the mighty hand, be upon them to guide them, encourage them, inspire them in the work they do. In our own diocese of Trinidad and Tobago, we lift up our Bishop Claude. We ask you to bless him and bless his family. Fill him, Lord, with your Holy Spirit and enable him to, inspired by that Holy Spirit, your Holy Spirit, enable him, Lord, to reach out and be a source of guidance and hope and love to all. We pray for all our clergy in our diocese of Trinidad and Tobago, in all our parishes, for your hand of blessing upon them, in the work they do as they seek to encourage your people and inspire them in the work of making you known wherever they are. We continue to pray for our country of Trinidad and Tobago. We lift up those you have put in leadership over us. We ask you to inspire them, Lord. Give them wisdom. Fill them with a desire to make a difference, to truly serve their country to the best of their ability. Help them to make the right decisions that will redound to the benefit of all. We pray for our people in this country. Bless us all. Give us a sense, Lord, that we are all in this together, called to support one another, called to work together for the common good. And so we pray for all those, Lord, who are going astray and falling in a life of crime. We pray for those who influence young people into crime. We pray, Lord, that you will touch hearts and minds in this country so that we all will consider ourselves as we truly are, your children and therefore brothers and sisters, concerned about the welfare of one another. We pray for those, all of us, Lord, who are in a position where we can lend a helping hand and reach out with material help, but also reach out in love. Help us, Lord, to be sources of your love in this country of ours, so that the work we do, our relationship with others, will seek to build up others. We pray for all those who work with our children, our teachers, coaches, church youth groups, all who are working with children in one capacity or another. Inspire them, Lord. Give them the wisdom, you know, beyond their own, your wisdom, that will enable them to reach each of their children under their charge and help them to go to their full potential. Help us to leave no room for those negative influences who want to lead our young people astray. We pray for those who are sick and suffering and crying out in their hearing today, those who mourn the loss of loved ones at this time. We pray for your consolation. For all those who suffering in one way or another, the unemployed, those unable to provide for their families, those who have awakened to a day where they do not know where their next meal will come from, parents at this time who need to get their books and uniforms for their children. Lord, help us as we are able to help others. Remember our senior citizens. Help us to open our eyes. Help us to see their needs and to reach out in love. We pray for your people in this land. Lord, help us to be sources of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue with the prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.